Is there X? This is where I equipped them, huh?
Commander?
How are we doing?
What's your opinion of the last mission?
Kinda wish you'd got there sooner, Commander.
Hmm.
No offense, I appreciate the rescue. I just wish...
that we'd saved your unit.
You wish we'd been able to save the rest of your unit.
Yes, ma'am. If I had been more alert, we wouldn't have been cut down by an ambush.
Don't blame yourself.
The Geth are perfect ambushers. They don't move, they don't make noise, they don't even breathe.
They have flashlight heads, ma'am. I'll make sure it doesn't happen again.
Flashlight heads. Can we talk?
Do you have a few minutes to talk? One-on-one?
I'm sorry, Commander. I need to get my duty squared away. I wouldn't mind talking more later, though.
I'm your commander. Damn.
Dismissed, Chief.
Ma'am.
If I want to talk, we talk. Wrex.
Nice ship you've got, Shepard. What can I do for you?
Personal inquiry.
What's your story, Wrex?
There's no story. Go ask the Quarian if you want stories.
Come on.
You Krogans live for centuries. Don't tell me you haven't had a few interesting adventures.
Well, there was this one time the Turians almost wiped out our entire race. That was fun.
It's unfortunate.
I heard about that. You know, they almost did the same to us.
It's not the same.
It isn't?
It seems pretty much the same to me.
So your people were infected with a genetic mutation? An infection that makes only a few in a thousand children survive birth? And I suppose it's destroying your entire species?
Not exactly. They just try to kill us outright.
I suppose it isn't all the same.
I don't expect you to understand, but don't compare humanity's fate with the Krogan.
Touchy subject.
I was just making conversation. I wasn't trying to upset you.
Your ignorance doesn't upset me, Shepard. As for the Krogan, I gave up on them long ago. The genophage infected us, but it's not what's killing us.
What's killing you, then?
Are your people really dying?
We're sure not getting any stronger. We're too spread out. None of us are interested in staying in our own system.
So?
Lots of species have left their homes and prospered.
But they go to colonize new worlds. We're not settlers. We're warriors. We want to fight. So we leave. Hire ourselves out. And most of us never go back.
Tell me about the genophage.
What can you tell me about the genophage?
Ask the Solarians if you want details. They made it. All I know, it makes breeding nearly impossible. Thousands die in stillbirth. Most never get that far. Every Krogan is infected. Everyone. And no one's rushing to find a cure.
What?
Why don't the Krogan try to find a cure?
When was the last time you saw a Krogan scientist? You ask a Krogan, would he rather find a cure for the genophage or fight for credits? He'll choose fighting every time. It's just who we are, Shepard. I can't change that. Nobody can.
Well, there had to be scientists who furthered your race and that you've become an intergalactic species. I mean, someone had to make your starships. I see.
So long, Wrex.
Shepard.
So I see you saying goodbye. Non-council races. The genophage bioweapons was created to end the Krogan rebellions. From the start, the Krogan had overwhelmed the Council. Only timely first contact with the Turians saved the Council races. The Turians fought the Krogan to a standstill, but sheer weight of Krogan numbers indicated the war could not be won through conventional means. The Turians collaborated with the Salarians to genetically engineer a counter to the rapid breeding of the Krogan. The genophage virus gained the energy to replicate by eating key genetic sequences. Every cell in the Krogan had to be altered for the weapon to be foolproof, otherwise the Krogan could have used gene therapy to fix the affected tissues. Once a genophage strain could find no more genes to eat, it would starve and die, limiting spin-off mutation and contamination. This creatogenic flaw is hereditary. The Salarians believed the genophage would be used as a deterrent, a position the Turians viewed as naive. Once the project was complete, the Turians mass-produced and deployed it. The Krogan homeworld, their colonies, and all occupied worlds were infected. The resulting mutation made only 1 in 1,000 Krogan pregnancies carry to term. It did not reduce fertility, but offspring viability. The rare females able to carry children to term became prizes the Krogan warlords fought brutal battles over. The Krogan are a shadow of their former glory. While the rebellions took place centuries ago, they are constantly reminded of the horror of the genophage and of their inability to counter it. The release of the genophage is still controversial, bitterly debated in many circles. Garrus.
Thanks for bringing me on board, Commander. I knew working with the Spectre would be better than life at CSEC.
You knew?
Have you worked with the Spectre before?
Well, no, but I know what they're like. Spectres make their own rules. You're free to handle things your way. At CSEC, you're buried by rules. The damn bureaucrats are always on your back.
True.
Being a Spectre does have its advantages.
Exactly my point. If I'm trying to take down a suspect, it shouldn't matter how I do it, as long as I do it. But CSEC wants it done their way. Protocol and procedure come first. That's why I left.
That was your reason?
So you just quit because you didn't like the way they do things?
There's more to it than that. It didn't start out bad, but as I rose in ranks, I got saddled with more and more red tape. CSEC's handling of Saren was typical. I just couldn't take it anymore. I hate me.
It's a tough decision.
I hope you made the right choice. I'd hate for you to regret it later.
Well, that's sort of why I teamed up with you. It's a chance for me to get off the Citadel, see how things are done outside CSEC. Either way, I plan to make the most of this. And without CSEC headquarters looking over my shoulder, well, maybe I can get the job done my way for a change.
Sounds good to me.
As long as you do your job well, you're free to go about your business as you see fit.
Thank you, Commander.
Anything else we can talk to him about?
Commander, good to see you.
Nope. Cool. Engineer Adams.
Hey, Commander, you know that Quarian, Tali? She's been spending all her time down here asking me about our engines.
She bothering you?
I'll tell her to leave you alone.
What? No, she's amazing. I wish my guys were half as smart as she is. Give her a month on board and she'll know more about our engines than I do. She's got a real knack for technology, that one. I can see why you wanted her to come along.
Yeah, she's useful.
I figured she'd be a real asset to the team.
You've got an eye for talent, Commander, but I'm guessing that's not why you came down here.
No, I wanted to hear about the stealth system.
Fill me in on the IES stealth system. How does it work exactly?
You can't hide a ship out in space. They emit too much heat and radiation. Too easy for sensors to pick them up, unless you find a way to capture those emissions. So our stealth systems trap the energy we give off in storage sinks built into the ship itself. No emissions to give away our location. Eventually, the sinks have to be vented. Hours silent running and they overheat, cook us inside our own hull.
So at that point we're invisible.
There's no way for anyone to detect us?
A visual scan can still pick us up. Anyone looking out a window can see us plain as day. But you have to be pretty close to get an actual visual out in space.
Hmm.
Most vessels rely on scanners. As long as the stealth systems are engaged, they can't see us. Not unless we accelerate to FTL speeds.
So FTL gives us away.
Why doesn't it work with faster than light travel?
Cranking up the FTL, blue shifts our emissions, pushes them into frequencies too high to capture in the sinks. As soon as we make the jump, it's like setting off a flare. Sensors can pick up our location whenever we enter or exit FTL flight, but for short-range missions, our stealth systems are amazing, and we've got the only one.
Cool. So you ask him stuff about the Normandy?
I want to know more about the Normandy.
She's the best ship I've ever served on, probably the fastest vessel ever designed. She's the only one using the new Tantalus drive core.
Drive core?
What's so special about the Tantalus drive core?
Proportionally, it's about twice the size of any other vessel. Not only are we faster, we can run at FTL speeds longer before we have to discharge the core.
Personal questions?
Where else have you served, Adams?
If you name a class of Alliance ship, I've probably served on it. Everything from dreadnoughts and carriers right down to frigates like the Normandy. My last assignment was on the Tokyo, only a cruiser, but she was a good ship. Couldn't hold a candle to the Normandy, though.
Okay, bye.
Carry on, Adams.
Aye, aye, Commander.
More codex stuff. Ships and vehicles.
Faster than light drives use... Larger warships are generally classified in one of four weights. Frigates are small, fast ships used for scouting and screening of larger vessels. Frigates often operate in wolf-pack flotillas. Cruisers are middleweight combatants, faster than dreadnoughts and more heavily armed than frigates. Cruisers are the standard patrol unit and often lead frigate flotillas. Dreadnoughts are kilometer-long capital ships mounting heavy, long-range firepower. They are only deployed for the most vital missions. Carriers are dreadnought-sized vessels that also carry large numbers of fighters. Smaller vessels are almost exclusively used in a support role to the warships during combat. Fighters are one-man craft used to perform close-range attacks on enemy ships. Interceptors are one-man craft optimized for destroying opposing fighters.
Cool. FTL drive might be new, I'm not sure.
Faster-than-light drives use element zero cores to reduce the mass of the ship, allowing higher rates of acceleration. This effectively raises the speed of light within the mass effect field, allowing high-speed travel with negligible relativistic time dilation effects. Starships still require conventional thrusters, chemical rockets, commercial fusion torch, economy ion engine, or military anti-proton drive, in addition to the FTL drive core. With only a core, a ship has no motive power. The amount of ESO and power required for a drive increases exponentially to the mass being moved and the degree it is being lightened. Very massive ships, or very high speeds, are prohibitively expensive. If the field collapses while the ship is moving at faster than light speed, the effects are catastrophic. The ship is snapped back to sublight velocity, the enormous excess energy shed in the form of lethal Cherenkov radiation.
I guess everyone dies at that point. Seems like.
Faster than light drop.
Tali over here? Yeah.
Your ship's amazing, Shepard. I've never seen a drive core like this before. I can't believe you were able to fit it into a ship this small. I'm starting to understand why you humans have been so successful. I had no idea Alliance vessels were so advanced.
Yeah, well, this ship's special.
The Normandy's a prototype, cutting-edge technology.
A month ago, I was patching a makeshift fuel line into a converted tug ship in the flotilla. Now, I'm sitting on board one of the most advanced vessels in Citadel space. I have to thank you again for bringing me along. Traveling on a vessel like this is a dream come true for me.
Well, that's not why you're here.
I didn't bring you along to admire my ship.
I know why I'm here. I'll do whatever I can to help you stop Saturn and drive his Geth armies back beyond the Veil.
What can you tell me about Quarians?
Tell me about your people.
Our lives aren't easy. Resources are scarce, and we are constantly on the move. Everything we do must in some way contribute to the continuation of the Migrant Fleet. There are 17 million Quarians in the flotilla, and each of us relies on the others for survival. The bonds among my people are strong. Unfortunately, we have had to surrender many of the freedoms and civil liberties other species take for granted.
Like what?
What kind of freedoms?
Well, it's illegal for parents to have more than one child. If our population grows too much, it would strain our resources to their breaking point. Of course, we also can't allow our numbers to become too few. If our population is in decline, the rule against single births is temporarily repealed. In extreme cases of population decline, incentives are even offered to encourage multiple births. Though the Conclave hasn't had to take such measures in nearly a century.
The Conclave?
That's your government.
The Conclave is our civilian branch of government. Each ship can elect a representative to serve on the Conclave and make decisions that affect the fleet as a whole. On matters that affect an individual ship, however, the captain has the final say. It's a tradition that dates back to the early days, when the fleet was governed by martial law. Fortunately, most captains nowadays are smart enough to have an elected council from their crew to give them advice and guidance.
So you're democratic?
So the ultimate power rests with elected officials?
In practice, the Conclave and the respective council for each ship tend to set the rules that govern our daily lives. But in theory, we are still under military jurisdiction. The 5 top-ranking military officials in the fleet serve on the Admiralty Board. These 5 have the power to overrule any decision by the Conclave in case of emergency. To do so requires unanimous agreement among the Admiralty. And they can only do this once. After that, the entire board must resign their posts. It's a safeguard that served us well. In nearly 3 centuries, the Admiralty Board has only overruled the Conclave 4 times.
The amount of lore and background in this game is staggering. What do you know about the Geth?
I want to know more about the Geth.
I doubt I can tell you anything you don't already know. It's been almost 3 centuries since they drove my people into exile. All I know is the story of their origins. What they were when we created them, and how they turned on us.
Tommy.
Interesting.
Or interesting.
The Geth were originally created to serve as an automated manual labor force. Initially, their intelligence was as limited as any VI. Over time, we made small modifications to their programming to allow them to perform more varied and complex tasks, bringing them closer and closer to true AI status.
Oh, that was a mistake.
You had to know it would blow up in your face.
The changes were so insignificant, so gradual, that we were able to control them. Or so we thought. But one thing we underestimated was the power of the neural network. A million Geth thinking simultaneously created an inherently unstable matrix.
The neural network?
So the Geth share brain power?
Many of the Geth's logic systems were designed to work in concert with other nearby Geth. Basically, the more of them you have in the group, the smarter they are.
Like a hive mind?
So there's some sort of group consciousness?
No, nothing like that. They cannot share sensory data or information. Their programming cannot handle that much simultaneous input. Each Geth maintains an individual awareness and identity. The neural network only operates on a process-based level. It's basically the synthetic equivalent of a subconscious. But when they're in close proximity, they can coordinate low-level functional processes, freeing up more capacity for original or independent thought.
Hmm. say I don't get it, maybe she'll explain it in a different way.
That doesn't make any sense.
I'm probably oversimplifying. The Geth are incredibly advanced and complex creations. All you need to know is that they get smarter when they gather in large numbers. As we built more and more Geth, their effective intelligence became more sophisticated, more abstract. One day, a Geth began to ask its Quarian overseer questions about the nature of its existence. Am I alive? Why am I here? What is my purpose? As you can imagine, this caused a near panic among my people.
I know why. I want to hear her say it, though.
I don't see what's so bad about those questions.
Sentience.
The Geth were created to engage in mundane, repetitive, or dangerous manual labor. That's fine for machines, but it won't satisfy a sentient being for long. The Geth were showing signs of rudimentary self-awareness and independent thought. If the Geth were intelligent, then we were essentially using them as slaves. It was inevitable the newly sentient Geth would rebel against their situation. We knew they would rise up against us, so we acted first. A general order went out across all Quarian-controlled systems to permanently deactivate all Geth. The Geth responded to this order violently.
Huh. Well, what did you expect? Oops, wrong one.
The war. The Geth were just fighting for their survival.
Yeah, that too.
We had no other choice. The Geth were already on the verge of revolution. By acting quickly, we had a chance to end the war before it began. The hope was that most of the Geth would still be little more than machines, incapable of organized resistance. But they had progressed much further than anyone anticipated. The war was long and bloody. Millions upon millions of Quarians died at their hands. In the end, we were forced to flee our own homeworld. We feared the Geth would pursue us, but they never came beyond the veil. Now we drift through space. Exile, searching for a way to reclaim what was once ours.
Now they defended themselves.
It's hard to feel sorry for you. Your ancestors tried to wipe out another species.
We made a mistake when we created the Geth in the first place. But we did not make a mistake when we went to war against them. If we had not acted, they would have wiped us out. They're a synthetic life form. They have no use for organics. None. Why do you think they cut themselves off from the rest of the galaxy? Why do you think they've killed every organic being who's ever tried to contact them?
Not everyone.
They didn't kill Saren.
What does that tell you? The Geth are not innocent victims in all this. They're the enemy. They want to destroy us. Not just the Quarians. All organic life. That's why they've joined up with Saren, and that's why we have to stop him.
That was quite a conversation. Tell me about your pilgrimage.
I want to know more about the pilgrimage.
When my people reach maturity, we leave our birth ships and seek acceptance with a new crew. It's necessary to maintain genetic diversity among the fleet. But no ship wants to accept someone who will be a burden on them. So, to prove our worth, we embark on a pilgrimage. We set out alone, leaving the flotilla and our families behind us. We only return once we have found something of value we can bring back to the fleet. This is presented as a gift to the captain of the respective ship we wish to join. If the gift is accepted, we are welcomed into the crew.
Do they always accept?
Can a captain choose to reject the gift?
That doesn't happen often. Most captains are eager to increase the size of their crew. It increases their own standing in our society. Even when a gift is not particularly valuable, the captain usually accepts it out of a sense of tradition. However, there is a stigma to presenting a substandard gift. It's not the best way to make a good impression on a new community. Most pilgrims don't return until they find something worthwhile.
Does it? It sounds dangerous.
I can't believe they just send you off alone.
Oh, yeah.
It's not like they just cast us out. Before we leave, we are given lessons in how to survive outside the flotilla, and given gifts to help us on our journey. We also receive implants to fight off sickness and disease. Generations of living in an isolated and highly controlled environment have left our immune systems weaker than most. By the time we leave the fleet, we are well equipped for the pilgrimage. This is a rite of passage for all Quarians. If it were dangerous, our numbers would suffer. Virtually every pilgrimage ends with a triumphant return and the ritual presentation of the gift to one of the fleet's captains.
I want to talk about something else.
Like what?
There is nothing else. So, bye.
I should go.
See you later.
That's what I wanted to talk about. Me going. Quarian's government. Due to the Quarian's precarious existence and the need to enforce strict rationing, government is somewhat autocratic. The migrant fleet's operations are directed by the Admiralty, a board of 5 military officers who are advised by a legislative body called the Conclave. Each vessel in the fleet has the right to send representatives to the Conclave aboard the flagship. The number of representatives is based on crew size. Larger clans with bigger ships and more votes form the cores of political blocks. Oppression comes from the Outriders Coalition with delegates from thousands of smaller ships. The Admiralty defers to the Conclave's decisions in most circumstances. However, if all 5 members agree that a Conclave decision jeopardizes the survival of the fleet and cannot get the Conclave to address their concerns, they have the right to summarily overturn the legislative decision. After the Admiralty uses this extraordinary power, they must resign. If the Admiralty does not step down after using their veto, the rest of the military is obliged to arrest them. Each ship captain has authority over his vessel, but is advised by the elected civilian council, just as the Admiralty is advised by the Conclave. This relationship may range from cooperation to polite tolerance to outright hostility, but any captain who overrules his council without good reason is relieved of command by the Admiralty. Many Quarian ships are owned by clans who pool their resources to purchase used vessels from private sellers. Large ships are prestigious for big, rich clans, but a small ship means status for a small clan with enough personal wealth to afford a private vessel. Clan vessel captains are not subject to dismissal by the Admiralty. Abusive captains are a family problem if they do not disrupt the operations of the fleet. Okay. Examine the Element Zero core. And we got Codex stuff again.
Biotics is the ability of rare individuals to manipulate. When subjected to an electrical current, the rare material dubbed Element Zero, or Ezo, emits a dark energy field that raises or lowers the mass of all objects within it. This mass effect is used in countless ways, from generating artificial gravity to manufacturing high-strength construction materials. It is most prominently used to enable faster-than-light space travel. Ezo is generated when solid matter, such as a planet, is affected by the energy of a star going supernova. The material is common in the asteroid debris that orbits neutron stars and pulsars. These are dangerous places to mine, requiring extensive use of robotics, telepresence, and shielding to survive the incredible radiation from the dead star. Only a few major corporations can afford the setup costs required to work these primary sources. Humanity discovered refined Element Zero at the Prothean Research Station on Mars, allowing them to create mass effect fields and develop FTL travel.
Pretty fortuitous find there. what's that? Deck one, back up. Okay. Okay, now can we talk to this guy? Hey.
If anyone has to take over for Captain Anderson, I'm glad it's you. I'm not sure about having non-humans on our ship, though.
I'm glad now you'll talk to me. They're on our side.
We're all on the same team here, Pressly.
With all due respect, ma'am, that's what they said about Nihilus. Look how that turned out.
You doubt my decisions?
I'm in charge here, Pressly. I decide if we have non-humans on this vessel.
Yes, ma'am. Understood, ma'am.
That's what I thought. Aliens on the ship.
Speak freely, Pressly. I want to know if you have a problem with non-humans.
Obviously
it's
does.
It's not that, Commander. Humanity has always handled its own problems. Saren attacked one of our colonies. We should be the ones to stop him. We don't need their help.
Well, it's not just our problem.
This is bigger than humanity. Saren's a threat to every species in the galaxy, and I'll welcome anyone who wants to help me bring him down.
I guess so. Maybe I'm just stuck in the old ways of thinking. But don't worry, Commander. This won't be a problem.
I hope not.
How did you end up assigned to the Normandy?
I signed up with the Alliance as a navigator right out of school, following in my grandfather's footsteps, I guess. My first posting was on the Agincourt. We were one of the first reinforcements to arrive at Elysium after the Blitz hit. Those raiders were no match for an Alliance frigate. Of course, the only reason the colony was still standing was because of you, Commander. I can't believe you held out as long as you did.
So now you're here.
How'd you end up on the Normandy?
I got my officer's commission after Elysium. Must have made an impression on the right people. Captain asked for me when he was picking his crew.
Okay. That'll be all.
Carry on, Pressly.
Yes, ma'am.
Paragon plus two, Renegade plus two, Codex. Human diplomatic relations. Humanity has encountered many galactic species. Wars have been few, but mistrust is rife. Politically, the Alliance is a peaceful trade partner of the Turians. As a practical matter, however, there is simmering antagonism and bigotry between both populations over the First Contact War of 2157. The Alliance enjoys good relations with the Asari, though many privately believe the Matriarchs are aristocratic and overcautious. Though humans know better than to unconditionally trust any Salarian, their shared restless, reckless ways make them natural allies against the conservative Turians and Asari. The Krogan have no unified government, but individuals are generally treated as potential criminals, a reputation most Krogan enjoy living down to. The Alliance has no formal contact with the Quarians. Their migrant fleet has not yet passed through any human-settled system. The Batarians are rivals for control of the Skillian Verge. They severed their treaties with the Citadel to prosecute a colonial conflict against the Alliance. Officially, there is no war, but neither is there any peace. Okay. Well, we're done talking, everybody, I think. Bridge. Airlock. This goes to back down. Communications is through here. Have I been through here? Oh, yeah. Comm room. Okay, it's empty. Okay, guys. I'm done messing around over here. Stay tuned for next episode when I finally reopen the galaxy map and we continue to a destination. I guess we're gonna go to one of those two worlds first, like the good former Captain Anderson said. We might have trouble finding the Asari for some reason. So maybe we should go to one of these worlds first, and maybe after. So, that doesn't make a lot of sense to me, but I don't want to go somewhere and just wander around and have nothing going on. That'd be kind of boring. I mean, interesting to see a location anyway, but yeah. I'll go to one of the worlds first, and of course we're gonna shoot lots of things and we might die. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.